We'll see why this man is said to be a paedophile in a moment, but let's examine first how Amaral describes the alleged paedophile based on Nuno Lourenco's description. Didn't look like a tourist, long brown hair down to his collar, cream-coloured trousers and jacket, shoes of a classic style. And it is claimed that he fled in a hired car. Dr. Amaral, who first became aware of this claimed sighting on Saturday the 5th of May, 2 days after Madeleine's disappearance on the 3rd of May, immediately grasped the significance of this sighting, as perhaps was the intention all along. He wrote in his book, "This report reminds us of the individual encountered by Jane Tanner in the streets of Villa de Luz on the evening of Madeleine's disappearance." Let's now examine in depth the statement of Nuno Lourenco and tell his story about a man he suggested was a paedophile who allegedly was taking photographs of young children on a beach and later tried to kidnap his daughter. As we'll see in a moment, the man turned out to be a Polish man from Warsaw named Wojciech Krakowski, on a week's holiday in the area, either with his wife or a lady friend. There are a number of very curious features surrounding the story. Nuno Lourenco told his police interviewer, Inspector João Carlos, that he is a Portuguese citizen who emigrated to Germany 14 years previously in 1993. Lourenco says he is the father of a girl aged nearly 4 and a boy almost 3. He says he was on holiday with his wife and children from the 22nd of April to the 13th of May, staying with his mother in Sagres. He goes on to give these details. On Sunday the 29th of April 2007, he says he had just returned his rental car and walked to the nearby Marita beach in Sagres, arriving there about 3 p.m. It is not clear why he handed in his rental car that day. According to his statement, by that day he had only been there a week and still had 2 weeks to go on his holiday. They, his wife and two children, all went to the play area, he says. He continues that between 4 p.m. and 5 p.m. he noticed a man holding a small silver-coloured camera who was sneakily taking pictures of children on the beach by covertly clicking a camera held near his waist. Lourenco even tells us that he was close enough to hear the clicking of his camera. The man then, says Lourenco, went on to take 3 or 4 pictures of Lourenco's children. Lourenco then saw him take pictures of 2 more boys, aged about 9 and 5, who were close by and playing with a ball, who were from another Sagres family he already knew. In the English translation of Nuno Lourenco's statement, it states that he had begun staring at this man with a camera indignantly and aggressively, but apparently did not actually confront him. Lourenco adds that before the man left the area, he sneakily took more pictures of all 4 children and of other children, this time with a camera held to his eye. Furthermore, says Lourenco, he also got on his knees in the sand to take additional photos. After this, says Nuno Lourenco, the man left and he did not see the individual and did not again think about the incident. Not only does he say that he did not think about it any more, but there is no indication that it ever occurred to Lourenco at this point to contact the police. Lourenco then says that at around 6 to 6:30 p.m. the same day, it got a bit colder, so they left the beach and headed towards the promenade to buy sweets at a pastry shop called Marrero's, about a quarter of a mile from the beach in Sagres. He and his family sat down, and as he was drinking coffee, he spotted the same man passing the pastry shop and heading for the edge of the promenade. He then adds that the man entered the shop but left immediately and was constantly looking at children. Lourenco continues in the English translation of his statement, "As the man left the pastry shop, his 3-year-old daughter began racing around the tables as they were ready to leave. Seeing this, the man began to walk rapidly towards Lourenco's daughter as the family were leaving the shop. By chance, his daughter stopped next to him as the man appeared to try to stop them from leaving. The man went into the pastry shop once again and left without buying anything. He then went to the back of a local kiosk." Lourenco then says that he has no doubt that the man intended to abduct his daughter. Therefore, he says, he got out his mobile phone and began taking various pictures of the man. He did so in front of the man so that he would clearly see that he was taking pictures of him. Then Lourenco explains to Inspector Carlos that the photo didn't come out on his mobile because he had his finger on the camera lens. Curiously, although he says he took pictures in the plural of this man, he only refers to a photo, singular, not coming out. Another point here, is it common for a mobile phone to fail because of a finger over its lens? Lourenco goes on to explain that the man had left the kiosk area. Lorenko followed him. He noticed that the man was now sitting behind the wheel of a newish grey Renault car. Lorenko, who must have taken a biro or pencil down to the beach with him, and some paper, now tells us that he noted the registration number on a piece of paper. A few minutes later, however, he tells us that he threw this piece of paper into a rubbish bin, or flung it on the ground, he can't remember which, as he didn't think it would be of any further use. Here we have two more points of interest. Once again, despite what he says is this dramatic attempt to snatch his young daughter, he still doesn't even think of contacting the police, nor does he bother to keep the registration number of the car in which the man has driven off. These are more issues that increase one's doubts about the entire story. Then we are told this. Lorenko saw that there was a woman in the passenger seat. He managed to take a photo of the car, which his camera said was taken at 6:08 p.m. on Sunday the 29th of April. At least he didn't have his finger in front of the lens this time. And maybe that's because this time he claims that he was taking a photo on his camera, not on his mobile phone. Yet he told the police nothing in his statement about going to get his camera. Has he now got both a mobile phone and a camera? The car is then said to have driven off in the direction of Segres Fortaleza. Here are the two photos said to have been taken by Lorenko that evening. It is not possible from this photograph to see if anyone was in the car, but that is Lorenko's story, i.e. that when he took this photograph, Wojciech Krakowski and his wife were both in the car, presumably about to drive off in haste. This would appear to be his only photograph of the entire incident. His daughter, he says, was nearly snatched by a paedophile brazenly taking pictures of young children on the beach. Yet, according to his account, for the next 5 days, he does nothing more about the incident. Then Lorenko tells the police about a further incident concerning this man, which he says happened on Friday the 4th of May, the day after Madeleine was reported missing. Reporting this incident to the police the following day, Inspector Carlos records that Lorenko told him as follows. Yesterday, 4th of May, Friday, he went to a rental car agency. The name of the agency was Turinfo, and is located in Sagres. It was around 1 p.m. Again, we find Lorenko at a car rental agency. He told police that he'd returned a car to the rental agency on the 29th of April. What was he doing at a car rental agency again? Was he now hiring another car? He says that the employee at the rental agency told them to return at 1:30 p.m., at which time the manager would arrive. It seems curious that only the manager could rent out cars. Lorenko says that he proceeded to a bar called Razados Ventos, where he ordered a coffee to pass the time. At a later point, looking out of the bar, he saw the same man, as on the previous Sunday, dressed in exactly the same fashion, he says, but without a hat. This man was alone and on foot and then left the area, and he didn't see him again, nor did he see his car. Upon returning home, says Inspector Carlos, Lorenko recounted the story to his wife, who told him to go to the police. This was because his wife had already, earlier that day, heard on the news about the disappearance of Madeleine. Lorenko's daughter apparently bore a striking resemblance to photographs of Madeleine. That very morning, 5th of May, Lorenko contacted the police and told them what had happened. Of the vehicle registration plate, he says he only remembered the partial plate, letters AV and numbers 67. So we are asked to believe the following. 1. That it had not occurred to Lorenko to contact the police before the 4th of May. 2. That as he went to the car rental agency, he happened to see the same man again, this time in a different location. And 3. That only after his wife mentioned Madeleine McCann did he and his wife even think of contacting the police. Even then, he delayed visiting the police until the following day, the 5th of May. The full description of the man Lorenko now gives to Inspector Carlos is as follows. Masculine, Caucasian, with Latin colouring, curly dark brown hair that ran down his neck, and in a ponytail, between 35 to 40 years of age, of medium complexion and around 170 to 175 centimetres in height. He did not have any distinguishing marks or signs and did not wear rings or other jewellery. He wore a cream-coloured beach hat. He also wore dark glasses. He wore cloth trousers and a coat stroke jacket of the same material, which was cream-coloured, and was almost the same colour to the hat he had worn previously. His shoes, he thinks, were dark brown, and of the type that need to be shined or polished, i.e. leather. there are obvious similarities between the two descriptions of a man that we've looked at so far, Jane Tanner's Tanner Man, and now Nuno Lorenco's Sagres Man. Tanner Man was dark-skinned, while Sagres Man had Latin colouring, medium complexion. Tanner Man and Sagres Man both described as 35 to 40. Height, Tanner Man 1.7 metres, Sagres Man around 170 to 175 centimetres. Hair, Tanner Man very dark, thick, longer at the back. Sagres Man curly dark brown hair that ran down the back of his neck and in a ponytail. Jacket and trousers, both Tanner Man and Sagres Man were described as wearing jacket and clothes made of the same cloth material, who were wearing light coloured trousers. Tanner Man's jacket was dark, however, while Sagres Man was wearing a cloth jacket. Shoes, both Tanner Man and Sagres Man were described as wearing classic shoes. Both, rather strangely, were described as not looking like a tourist. This description might stem from Nuno Lorenco's reference to Krakowski and his partner both wearing rather unusual warm clothing. The striking comparison between the two descriptions is obvious, as Dr. Amaral pointed out so clearly in his book. The stranger, Sagres Man, did not look like a tourist, brown hair down to his collar, wearing cream-coloured trousers and jacket and shoes of a classic style. This report reminds us of the individual encountered by Jane Tanner in the streets of Villa de Luz on the evening of Madeleine's disappearance. Inspector Carlos's report continues, "As regards the woman with the individual, as he saw her seated in the vehicle, he can only state that she had short hair which appeared to be white in colour and very shiny. In the sitting position, her head was below the car headrest. She appeared to be skinny and Caucasian. She did not use glasses. He can say no more, as she was difficult to see." When questioned, the witness states that he could recognise the individual in person and from a photograph or sketch. And indeed, Lorenco did eventually recognise Krakowski from a photograph shown to him by the police once they had traced him. Let's just go back for a moment to the account in Dr. Amaral's book, published in July 2008. Thanks to the father's composure, he managed to take a photograph of the vehicle. It's not very clear and does not allow us to make out the number plate, but we succeed nonetheless in finding the car. The car hire firm provides us with the identity of the driver. He is a 40-year-old Polish man who was travelling with his wife. They arrived in Portugal on April the 28th from Berlin at Faro Airport. They hired a car and stayed in an apartment in Budens near Praia da Luz. Unfortunately, on May the 5th at 7 a.m, they had already left, taking with them their camera and all the photographs from their holiday. We ask the German police through Interpol to monitor them as soon as they arrive in Berlin. All the passengers are questioned, but no one has seen a child looking like Madeleine. In Berlin, the couple take the train to return to Poland. Thus, the Polish trail comes to an end. We would like to have seen their photos, but that proved impossible. It's clear from this, then, that the Portuguese police rapidly set about finding the mystery photographer on Moretta Beach in Sagres, who turned out to be the 40-year-old Polish Wojciech Krakowski. Let's take a brief look into the Portuguese police files, what else they managed to establish about Krakowski. The Renault Clio vehicle, registration number 15AV67, was traced to the headquarters of a car rental company, Luzcar Rent-A-Car. The car was rented at Faro Airport on Saturday the 28th of April to Wojciech Krakowski. A hire contract drawn up by Nelson Martins, an employee of the agency, was found. Krakowski and his wife were staying at number 2C in an accommodation block called Edificio Solimar in Fictitia, which appears to be the name of the road in Burgau. The Solimar block was managed by a company called ATB, situated at Main Street, Moretta's Building, Burgau, in the municipality of Villa de Bispo. The police contacted its director, Nuno Felisberto. The apartment actually belonged to Peter and Margaret O, who live in Windsor Grove, Cardiff, Wales. The apartment had not been relet or cleaned after the couple's departure. The key was given to the police in case they wanted to check it, which they did. He had arranged this accommodation via the internet. His reservation email was found. He paid for the accommodation with his credit card. The files tell that Krakowski's vehicle was returned to the hire company on the 5th of May 2007 at Faro Airport and had already been washed and hired out again to one Claire E. at Parc de Floresta in Budens, Vila do Bispo. Further examination of the released Portuguese files show that they promptly and efficiently conducted their investigations, despite the constant smearing of them in British mainstream press, which claimed they were incompetent. The further information that the police gleaned from their inquiries included the following. The police contacted several business establishments in the area to determine the comings and goings of the Polish couple. One man, the owner of a beach bar, thought he recognised the couple from the police's description of them. He told the police that, 1, he recalled that the couple had lunch and dinner there 2 or 3 times at the beginning of the week. 2, he knows that they are Polish because they spoke about football on the day of the Liverpool-Chelsea match, Tuesday the 1st of May, saying that Liverpool's goalkeeper was Polish. 3, they also discussed Portuguese and Brazilian classical music. The Polish couple knew several performers from those countries. They asked the owner of the bar where they could buy music of this genre. The owner directed them to the FNAC shop at the Algarve Shopping Centre or to the Chiado Commercial Centre. 4, they said they would probably go to Lisbon the same day. To the restaurateur, the couple seemed quite atypical of holidaymakers to that place. They paid in cash, the lady was often irritated, and they dressed more formally than you would expect for a summer holiday at a beach. The owner, however, did not perceive any abnormal behaviour from the couple. The police were able to establish that the couple did indeed visit FNAC at the Chiado Commercial Centre on the 2nd of May 2007, where they bought 2 comedy musical CDs, paid for with a credit card, the same one used to pay the Luzcar rent-a-car company for the hire of the vehicle, registration 15AV67. The police seized the CCTV and extracted a still photograph of the Polish couple in the shop. Finally, the Portuguese police contacted Interpol in Germany and Poland. This is the information they received. From Interpol Germany, information was sent to Warsaw for them to trace and interview the Polish couple. Air Berlin said that Poles used the connection route via Berlin because there were no direct flights to and from Portugal / Faro. There were no suspicious reservations pertaining to children. Passengers in seats around the Krakowskis were shown pictures of Madeleine. All said that the couple was not accompanied by any child. From Interpol Warsaw, at 7:10 a.m. on Sunday the 6th of May, the Polish police interviewed the couple in their home apartment, which was searched. Madeleine was not found. They had left Berlin by train at 9:22 p.m. on the 5th of May and arrived back in their home at 6:45 a.m. It appears that the police did not check the couple's cameras. Before we move on, we are surely entitled to query why Nuno Lourenco does nothing about his child having been nearly kidnapped for several days, then only bothers to contact the police moments after Krakowski takes off heading back to Poland. And as we've seen, Lourenco's sighting has a dramatic impact on Dr. Amaral and his team. They act instantly, clearly thinking that must be the same man that Jane Tanner saw. Here I must ask the question, was this so-called sighting a complete setup? Suppose there never was an abduction. Suppose that Madeleine died much earlier than the alleged abduction and they needed a cover story. What better than to have 2 separate people, Jane Tanner and Nuno Lourenco, with 2 near identical descriptions, to give to the police soon after they report Madeleine missing? Could Nuno Lourenco and Jane Tanner both have based their descriptions on Wojciech Krakowski? Were they both handed the same script? I suggest that this scenario is probable. Is it possible that when Lourenco made his dramatic claims to the Portuguese police, he already knew, 1, that Jane Tanner had already made a statement about a man seen with a child on the evening of the 3rd of May, and 2, that Krakowski was already on a plane back to Poland? I suggest he may have made the whole story up. I suggest he went to the police with 1 tangible piece of evidence, namely a photograph of Krakowski's hired car, and knew the police would soon be able to trace Krakowski. I suggest the alleged attempted kidnapping incident was a fabrication. If so, could this fabrication have been instigated by those closer to the Madeleine incident? Was a story cunningly built with Krakowski as the perpetrator? If so, it succeeded. The Portuguese police were fooled. It seems crystal clear that Krakowski and his lady partner had nothing whatsoever to do with the reported disappearance of Madeleine McCann. By the time the Portuguese police had heard from Interpol, presumably sometime on Sunday the 6th of May, there was absolutely no evidence that the couple were in any way connected with Madeleine's disappearance. Yet within 5 days, there was a spate of well-sourced stories in the British mainstream press claiming that Sagres Mann was the main suspect. How did this come about? Let's now examine some of these stories about Lourenco's claims. Two stories, one in the Daily Mail, the second in the Daily Telegraph, appeared on the 11th and 12th of May 2007 respectively. The first was headed, "Did Madeleine's abductor target her after family's visit to remote village?" Here are some extracts from it. Madeleine McCann and her family visited the same remote village where a suspected paedophile was chased away for photographing young girls, it has emerged. It may have been the moment her abductor first laid eyes on the 3-year-old, who was snatched from her bed 3 days later. The McCann's day trip to Pretty Sagres, 16 miles along the coast from Praia da Luz, coincided with reports of a balding man with a blonde woman taking sneaky pictures of youngsters. The sinister couple have become prime suspects in the hunt for missing Madeleine. A holidaymaker grew suspicious of them after the man began secretly snapping youngsters on the beach. When challenged, he fled in a car with the woman. Officers have now officially ended the ground search for missing Madeleine and are concentrating on evidence from witnesses. The McCanns are believed to have visited Sagres, which is on the country's southwest tip and effectively the land's end of mainland Europe, on Monday, April the 30th. A shopkeeper in the town said she remembered them well. She said, "On the road into the town, Kate was holding Madeleine's hand. On the other side of the road was Jerry with a baby buggy. I remember thinking it odd to see him with a baby buggy because I thought the little girl was too old to need one." She said it was the same day as the stranger taking photographs, although other witnesses said that happened 2 days later. Either way, it seems possible that Madeleine's abductor was watching the beach at Sagres for some time. Holidaymaker Nuno Lourenco, who is from Sagres but now lives in Germany, was sitting at a cafe with his German wife and their 2 children when he noticed a man taking pictures of his 4-year-old blonde daughter and other children. He became so concerned at his behaviour that he took his own picture of the man, who was balding with long hair at the back, on his mobile phone. The picture is believed to have inspired Portuguese detectives to produce their infamous egg with hair photo fit of a suspect with a blank face and side parted hair. It was also reported the police have identified 2 people caught on CCTV at a local petrol station as being a couple renting a holiday apartment in the Chocolate Box village of Bergau, 4 miles along the coast. A blonde woman with shoulder-length hair and a man with middle-parted hair, both about 40, ate breakfast on their terrace of the Solomar Apartments, according to the Portuguese press. However, the apartment block in question was deserted, and neighbours said they knew nothing about it. Let's pause there a moment and consider these elements of the story. The couple caught on CCTV at a local petrol station, referred to in the article, is, by the way, also Krakowski and his female. First, we note that this account differs from Dr. Gonçalo Amaral's account in his book. He writes that the photographer tried to kidnap his daughter. But in his first account of the alleged encounter in the Daily Mail of the 11th of May, we read of no such kidnap event. The report simply says that Lourenco noticed a man taking pictures of his 4-year-old blonde daughter and other children and became concerned at his behaviour. There's no mention of the claimed kidnap attempt outside the pastry shop. Amaral obviously had the advantage of seeing Lourenco's witness statement. Amaral clearly believed that Lourenco was a witness of truth. Second, we note how conveniently this story supports the early claims by the McCanns that their daughter was abducted, perhaps by a paedophile. This event, the McCanns' alleged visit to Sagres, which supposedly happened on the 30th of April, was described by the Daily Mail as possibly the moment her abductor first laid eyes on the 3-year-old who was snatched from her bed 3 days later. It was just so easy for the media, and hence the public, to make the connection. A man tries, so it is said, to snatch a 3-year-old blonde girl from the beach days before Madeleine is reported missing. Then the McCanns allegedly visit the same remote village of Sagres. It is claimed, in effect, that this photographer tried to snatch a three-year-old girl on Sunday, then saw Madeleine and her parents in the village on Monday, and then 3 days later abducted her. It sounds far-fetched, but that is the narrative the Daily Mail readers were invited to follow. Third point, did the McCanns actually visit Sagres on the Monday, as claimed in this article? We have the witness of the shopkeeper, who according to Dr. Amaral, remembered the McCanns well. She said, on the road into the town, Kate was holding Madeleine's hand. On the other side of the road was Jerry with a baby buggy. I remember thinking it odd to see him with a baby buggy because I thought the little girl was too old to need one. She said it was the same day as the stranger taking photographs, although other witnesses said that happened 2 days later. If the McCanns really were in Sagres on Monday the 30th of April, one key question is, how did they get there? They told police that they did not have access to a car that week, yet Sagres is 15 or 16 miles from the village of Praia da Luz. The Daily Mail account seems pretty clear. It says, Madeleine McCann and her family visited the same remote village, and to the McCann's day trip to Pretty Sagres, 15 miles along the coast from Praia da Luz. But when we read Dr. Kate McCann's account of that day, Monday the 30th of April, there is no reference whatsoever to this day trip to Sagres. Indeed, there is no mention by the McCanns of a day trip anywhere, never mind Sagres. On the contrary, the creche records kept by Mark Warner show quite clearly that all three children, Sean and Amelie and Madeleine, were in their creche that day. So these accounts seem impossible to reconcile. Whoever was the source for this story states the McCanns were in Sagres on Monday the 30th of April. A shopkeeper remembers seeing Kate, Jerry, Madeleine and a buggy in Sagres, but no twins. And there is no mention of this claimed visit in Dr. Kate McCann's detailed account of that week. So what is the truth? Did they go on a day trip to Sagres that day or not? Where did this story of the day trip to Sagres really come from? The evidence that they were there that day, or any other day, comes only from two British newspapers which don't disclose their sources. The evidence from the unnamed woman who claims to have seen the McCanns and Madeleine, but not the twins, is suspect. So I suggest this visit to Sagres may have never happened. All the McCanns' children were recorded in the creche register that day. Even if they did go to Sagres, creche evidence shows Madeleine was not with them, as claimed by the woman. It could have been a case of mistaken identity. And how did they get there? They didn't have a car and there was no regular bus service to and from Sagres. The claim that the McCanns were in Sagres that day seems quite unlikely. Far more likely, in my view, is whoever supplied this story to the newspapers, probably someone close to the McCann team, made up the McCanns' visit to Sagres in order to promote the emerging tale that Madeleine had been abducted by a paedophile obsessed with very young blonde girls. The paper refers vaguely to this story emerging. From where? From the police? That seems highly unlikely. Surely if the police were still interested in the Polish couple, they would be covertly asking the Polish police to make further inquiries, not placing stories in the British press. And what about the Daily Mail's reference to the sinister couple, the Krakowskis? The Mail story was on the 11th of May, yet by the 6th of May, 5 days earlier, the Portuguese police, the German police, the Polish police and Interpol had all been involved and eliminated the Krakowskis. They had nothing whatsoever to do with Madeleine's disappearance. Yet the Mail, presumably briefed by a source close to the McCann team, had described them as a sinister couple. So now let's look at the Daily Telegraph version of this story the following day. Abductors could have spied on girl for days. Police were last night investigating whether Madeleine McCann was watched by her abductors 3 days before she was snatched. Detectives have discovered that the McCann family went to the town of Sagres on the southern tip of the Algarve on April the 30th. A witness has told police that on the same day he saw a suspicious man following families and photographing children, including his daughter, a blonde girl strikingly similar to Madeleine. A witness, Nuno Lorenco, said he saw a man following his family down the beach and taking discreet photographs. He said he challenged the man, who fled with a blonde woman in a Renault Clio. This story gives another twist. This time Lorenko, or the Telegraph, is suggesting that he and the McCanns were both in Sagres on Monday the 30th of April, whereas in his statement he says that he and his family were in Sagres the previous day, Sunday the 29th. Which is it? He is also quoted as saying that the man was following his family down the beach, taking discreet photographs, and is said to have challenged the man. In his statement, however, he doesn't say that he was followed down the beach, nor did he challenge the man while they were at the beach. He says he only did so at a shop 2 hours later. The Telegraph article also proclaimed, "Detectives have discovered that the McCann family went to the town of Sagres. As we have just seen, that claim is suspect." It seems there was precious little truth in either of these articles. So let's now conclude our look at the alleged sighting of Sagres Man by examining a few more aspects of the story. We'll go back to Dr. Amaral's account of Sagres Man, that is, Wojciech Krakowski. He writes in Chapter 3, "We circulate a photo which we obtained thanks to a surveillance camera in a Lisbon shopping mall, amongst holidaymakers, clients and employees of Praia da Luz restaurants. Fruitlessly, nobody saw them. On the other hand, employees of the restaurant they usually went to in the Burgau Budens area remember them. The woman was usually in a bad mood and both wore clothes totally inappropriate to the place and the time of year. The forensic police won't be able to investigate their hire vehicle, which we managed to locate, because it has already been rented out again. All that's left to us is to find the bin in which the cleaning team dumped the rubbish left in the vehicle. Analysis of the rubbish reveals nothing. Fortunately, no one else has yet occupied the apartment the couple stayed in. It's low season. We go ahead with a thorough search, looking for evidence of a child's presence, shoe prints, fingerprints or footprints. Nothing. We then gather various hair samples, doubtless coming from adults, and notice drops of blood on a kitchen unit. Nothing conclusive. It's probably from an everyday domestic accident. We know that the apartment that the couple were staying in was in Burgau Budens, known as the Solimar building. This apartment block in Burgau has interesting links to Robert Murat. His father's company actually built this block, and there are suggestions that the company, ATB, also continues to manage the block to this day. In addition, we know that Robert Murat's uncle, Ralph Everley, provided the CCTV footage to the Portuguese police of the Polish couple visiting his beach bar in Burgau. This is another connection with Murat. It was also at the home of Ralph Everley and his wife Sally that, on the 13th of November 2007, a meeting took place between Robert Murat team, Murat, his mother, his aunt Sally and uncle Ralph Everley, and Murat's high-profile lawyer, Francisco Pagaret, with the McCann team, the head of their private investigations, Cheshire businessman Brian Kennedy, the McCann's coordinating lawyer and Freemason, Edward Smethurst. There is an interesting report in the Portuguese police files concerning DNA found at the Solimar apartment block where Krakowski was staying. Here are two extracts from this report. The first concerns Robert Murat. The haplotype identified by the letters MEM star present in 49 samples, 35 in the Residencia Liliana, 13 in the vehicle Volkswagen and 1 in the bathroom of the apartment in Burgau, and identical to that of Robert Murat, meaning those samples were from that person or individuals of the same maternal bloodline. The second extract I would highlight is about Jane Tanner. The report reads, "The haplotype identified by the letter S, present in 2 samples, apartment in Burgau, and identical to that of Jane Tanner, meaning those samples were from that person or individuals of the same maternal bloodline." So, what is this suggesting? I am not an expert in genetics, and I would ask the question, is this suggesting that Jane Tanner may have visited the apartment block where Wojciech Krakowski was staying? I am not saying this happened, but if it did, why might she have gone there? As we saw, the Portuguese police were first tipped off about the Polish couple on Saturday the 5th of May, but only after the Polish couple had already left Burgau for Poland. There is also a reference on the Lobster Crash record sheet that week for the daughter of tennis-playing Dr. Julian Totman for the 3rd of May, the same crash which Madeleine attended. He writes on the crash sheet, "Burgau Walk." It is not clear what is meant by that. Bergau was certainly near enough for someone to walk there and back in a morning or afternoon. Also of interest is that when Jerry McCann returned to Praia da Luz from his trip to Washington, he immediately drove to Vila do Bispo. Vila do Bispo is a small town about 14 miles west of Lagos and the centre of the municipality, which includes towns such as Sagres, Budens, Bergau and Moreta Beach. The whole story of Sagres Man seems could be interconnected in a mysterious way with Robert Murat, his aunt and uncle, the Everleys, and the villages of Bergau and Sagres. So how do Bergau and Sagres fit into the story of that fateful week's events? Is it possible, for example, that this Polish couple were connected to Robert Murat's then-girlfriend, now wife, Michaela Walczuk, who was also of Polish origin? I'll finish my look at Sagres Man with a summary of the series of major questions about Sagres Man. Let's briefly list them. On what date did Luna Marenko see Wojciech Krakowski? Did the McCanns visit Sagres as claimed? How credible is the claim that Krakowski tried to snatch Lorenko's daughter away from him outside the pastry shop? Why didn't Nuno Lorenko contact the police immediately on his mobile about the attempted kidnap of his daughter? Why did he report these incidents only after Wojciech Krakowski was already on his way back to Poland? There is a complete lack of corroboration for this story. Where are the witness statements from anyone else on the beach who saw the man with the camera, especially the parents of the two boys, or the witness statements from the people who saw the attempted kidnap, the staff of the shop, the customers, others passing by who would have seen the man run off? I'm not aware that any exist. What about Lorenko's description of the man's actions at the pastry shop? Going through his statement, Lorenko says the man comes in, goes out straight away, then comes back in again. As far as the claim of a kidnap attempt is concerned, there is no mention of him grabbing his daughter's arm or even trying to. The word he uses to refer to this in the English translation of them were, as the man appeared to try to stop them from leaving. That is a vague description. How exactly did he appear to try to stop them from leaving? Lorenko doesn't say. There is also the matter of the third alleged encounter with this man on Friday the 4th of May. Lorenko says he went to a car rental agency, Turinfo, in Sagres. It is not stated why he went, though presumably it was about renting a car. According to his witness statement, he was visiting his mother in Sagres, arriving on the 22nd of April and leaving on the 13th of May. It is not immediately obvious why, 12 days after arriving in Portugal, he suddenly visits a car rental agency with just 9 days of his holiday left, having already hired a car earlier in the holiday. He certainly doesn't tell us why in his statement. He says he sees the same man in Sagres. This is odd. We have established that the Polish couple were staying in the Solomar apartments in Bergau, which is some distance away from Sagres. Why, when at the beginning of the week, Wojciech Krakowski had practically been chased out of Sagres, had a photo of his face taken outside a pastry shop and been photographed in his car, would he contemplate revisiting Sagres on the last day of his holiday? It is hardly a rational thing to do. And once again, although Lorenko sees the man again, he doesn't contact the police. He only does so a day later. In my judgment, these concerns, and I've mentioned 11 separate issues altogether, raise serious doubts about whether any of Lorenko's story can be believed. To my knowledge, no other local people or tourists can be found who could confirm any of Lorenko's claims. The only other evidence we have about the couple's activities that week comes from a barmaid at the beach bar owned by Robert Murat's uncle, Ralph Everley. It amounts to this. The man talked about Liverpool-Chelsea football match on Tuesday the 1st of May. His wife looked irritated some of the time. They talked about their love of Portuguese and Brazilian comedy music, and the Polish couple went to a local music shop in the Algarve on Wednesday the 2nd of May. They dined several times at Ralph Everley's beach bar, and that's it. The claim that the Polish man may have seen Madeleine with the McCanns at Sagres fails because from the evidence available, it looks like the McCanns may have never went there. That claim by the mystery shopkeeper, who says she saw Kate holding Madeleine's hand with Jerry McCann on the other side of the road with a baby buggy, also seems doubtful. In his book, Dr. Amaral complains that on Sunday the 6th of May, the day gets off to a difficult start with bad news from Poland. From all accounts, the police badly misinterpreted our request for collaboration. All they did was approach the couple and verify that Madeleine was not with them, but they didn't seize either their photographic equipment or the photos taken during their holiday. Another lead that remains pending. Perhaps it would have led to the discovery of a paedophile ring. Well, if Amaral had had the benefit of the 7 years more knowledge of the twists and turns in this case that we have all had since he was booted off the inquiry, perhaps not. Wojciech Krakowski can hardly be considered a potential paedophile on the slender basis of Nuno Lorenco's tales. Maybe if Amaral could have a look again at all the evidence about Sagres' man, he might now consider that he and his men may have been tricked by what looks like it could be a fabricated sighting. To sum up, the whole story of Sagres' man is shot through with significant contradictions and mysteries. There's no credible evidence to my knowledge that the Polish man was photographing anyone, still less that he tried to kidnap anyone. Was this a fabrication designed partly to put the Portuguese police off the scent and also to give an exciting news angle on Madeleine's abduction to the hungry British mainstream media? They certainly are burying this story.